Hello, I am Julian Bro, an economist and policy specialist. I will be teaching you today about supply, demand, and government policies. Specifically, we will focus on controls on prices. Controls on prices are a common tool in the economic policy toolkit. We will first see how supply and demand work. Then, we will explain what price controls are. Finally, we will present the effects of price controls. First, supply and demand. The prices and quantities of products sold depend on supply and demand. Supply is the amount of a product that is produced by a supplier. It can be a good or a service. It can only be observed at a certain point in time. The more the price of a product increases, the more quantity of this product the suppliers offer, and vice versa. This allows the producer to maximize its profits. The relationship between price and quantity is hence positive. We represent this relationship as is. On the y-axis, price. On the x-axis, quantity. The relationship, geometrically speaking the slope, is positive. After supply, demand. Demand is the desire of the consumer to purchase a product and his, her willingness to pay the price for it. The product can be a good or a service. It can only be observed at a certain point in time. It is a willingness that can only be observed when the act of buying is realized. The more the price of a product increases, the less quantity of this product the consumer is ready to buy, and vice versa. This allows the consumer to maximize his or her welfare. Demand follows an inverse logic compared to supply. For the consumer, as prices go up, the quantity they are willing to buy decreases. Where the supply curve and demand curve meet, here are the equilibrium price and the equilibrium quantity. This is the quantity that will be produced and sold and the price at which it will be sold. This graph produces a global vision of the market for a certain good. Now, let's talk about price controls. Governments can intervene in the setting of supply and demand and modify the equilibrium price and quantity. A first example of government policy is price controls. For instance, if there is an oil crisis and a sudden increase in the price of oil, the government might limit the price of gasoline at X dollars per gallon. Or if there is a food crisis and a shortage of food, it can cap the price of bread at X dollars a piece. Or if there is social unrest and strikes, it can fix a floor to wages, which are the price of labor, thanks to a minimum wage. If house prices are very high, governments can enact rent control, which limits the level of rents. These are all price control policies. There are two main types of price controls: ceilings and floors. Let's analyze the effect of price controls. This is a market. For a price ceiling, the government fixes a maximum price over which the product cannot be sold. It can be non-binding. This means that it is above the equilibrium price. In this case, what happens? Nothing. Because the equilibrium price is below the new maximum price, the producers would in any case not be willing to propose products at this new price. The price control is non-binding. Generally, the price ceiling is binding, meaning that it is lower than the equilibrium price. Since prices have gone down, the producer will decrease the quantity it produces. Indeed, it cannot produce more because it would place it outside of its supply curve. There will hence be a shortage of the product on the market. A share of the population will want to buy the product, but won't be able to get it. This is why, in general, all things equal, price controls will introduce inefficiencies on markets, a waste of resources. In the worst case scenario, it may even induce black markets. As a consequence, price ceilings can have many negative effects. They can lower the quantity of goods available. This can induce an inefficient allocation to customers and wasted resources. At the extreme, consumers can shift away from official markets towards black markets. All those negative consequences mean price ceilings have a social cost. This social cost can be modeled as this orange triangle. It is called the deadweight loss. Some common mistakes about price controls. Some will say that they are always beneficial for society. For instance, if there is a sudden increase in the price of a product. In fact, this is not necessarily true. There is a cost, the deadweight lost, we just demonstrated. Second, price controls would benefit consumers to the detriment of producers. In fact, the deadweight loss is a cost for the whole of society, consumers included. Second common mistake, elasticity can be fully observed. Time for a quick exercise. What are the effects of a price floor? 1. It decreases quantities sold. 2. It increases quantities sold. 3. It has no effect. Remember the supply-demand model. The government introduces a floor, that is, a minimum price under which the product may not be sold. This price is usually fixed above the equilibrium price. This could be the case for the price of labor, which means a minimum wage. The quantity demanded is below the equilibrium quantity. For instance, if the minimum wage increases, a firm will hire less workers. It cannot place itself outside of its labor demand curve. There is, as a consequence, a shortage in quantities sold or a surplus in quantities offered compared to quantities effectively sold. On the labor market, unused surplus labor would be unemployment. This also introduces inefficiencies on markets, all things equal. This also creates a deadweight loss, shown by the orange triangle. Answer 1. It decreases quantities sold. A quick recap. We have seen in this class that the prices and quantities of products sold depend on supply and demand. Governments can intervene to introduce price controls. These are typically ceilings or floors. Both cause shortages in quantities of sold products and a deadweight social loss. We analyzed here price controls, all things equal, elsewhere. In reality, many policies are implemented at the same time, which makes the economic analysis more complex. Thanks for watching. Check out Chegg for more resources on macroeconomics.